Welcome to today's Remembrance Day service. The 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month. Today marks 98 years since the end of the Great War, the war to end all wars, World War I. Since 1918, Canadians have taken this hour, this day, and this month to remember. As you filed into the Kelly Theater this morning, you would have seen our most treasured archival pieces from the old chapel at Brentwood Bay. This honor roll displays every Brentonian that served during World War II, with the center reserved for those Brentonians that gave the ultimate sacrifice, their lives. Later in the service, those names will be read out by three of our prefects, Alejandro, Toria, and Santiago. One name you'll hear is from the famous 1940-41 First 15 rugby squad, whose remarkable record that season ended with 248 points for and only 23 against. His name is Ian Gillespie. During that magical season, they lost only one match to Navy. A teammate of Ian's, Colin Lytton Graham, immortalized his friend with this poem, A Distant Time. You will see the words of this poem engraved just outside Roger's house on the way to the rugby pitch. It reads, in the changing room after the Navy game, he said, Indian, I've joined the Air Force. Through the steam from the showers, he was already a ghost. Live forever, pussycat, I said. I promised you, you'll live forever. We're all immortal when we go to war. You were posted missing in action. The next I knew, your bowfighter went down on bomber escort over the channel. At Runnymede, I saw your name 20 years later. It seemed a terrible waste for the best fullback in the world. The citation said you'd die drawing enemy fire. What else? You'd called for the mark safe as houses. You tackled like a rattlesnake. You didn't leave the kitchen when the fire got hot. I promised you you'd live forever. Well, almost. While I live, so do you. Over the past 116 years in the 20th and 21st centuries, the total number of casualties of war is in excess of 162 million people. These people had mothers, fathers, spouses, children, and friends. No matter the side, the bloodshed, the sadness, and the resilience is the same. Most recently, the crisis in Syria has reported a death toll of over 400,000 people, with another 4.8 million being refugees that have fled to Turkey, Lebanon, Jordan, Egypt, Iraq, and yes, Canada, and another 6.6 million being internally displaced within Syria. Sadly, conflict and war still ravage today's world. Canadian John McCrae's famous poem in Flanders Fields speaks perhaps most directly to us here at Brentwood. The crest you so proudly wear on your chest this morning links us to our past. One of the lines in his poem reads this, to you from failing hands we throw the torch, be yours to hold it high, de manu in manum. That's why we wear poppies today. That's why today we pause to reflect on our past, learn from our past, and try to get better each and every day. That's the Canadian way, and that's the Brentwood way. As we live, so do they, lest we forget. Please stand for the singing of our national anthem.
Thank you. the Great War. It has been described as the first modern industrial war. A tragic human irony is that war accelerates technology, producing killing machines that, when combined with mass production, caused mass consumption of men and resources on an unprecedented scale. Static trench warfare on the Western Front led to costly battles of attrition in which both sides suffered appalling losses. One such battle happened in the Valley of the Somme one century ago. The British launched a massive offensive against the German lines in an attempt to cause a breakthrough and take the pressure off their French allies. A massive preliminary bombardment of 1.2 very expensive shells was so loud that it could be heard in London. Unfortunately for the British troops waiting in their trenches for the signal to attack, the artillery fire did little to break up the barbed wire in no man's land, and the German soldiers were largely unscathed, huddled deep underground in their concrete bunkers. Despite this, the order was given for the attack to proceed, and the first wave went over the top. Winston Churchill described the German trench system at the Somme as the most perfectly defended position in the world. The British advance on that day, which included the Newfoundland Regiment, walked across no man's land, burdened by packs weighing between 60 and 100 pounds, into the teeth of a gale of bullets from carefully positioned machine guns. An American industrialist named Hiram Maxim remarks somewhat prophetically, "If you want to become rich beyond your wildest dreams, invent something that will allow the Europeans to kill each other at will." Hiram Maxim, of course, invented the Maxim machine gun, capable of firing 550 bullets a minute. Needless to say, the attack was stopped dead. The Newfoundland Regiment at Beaumont Hamel suffered 90% casualties. Every officer was killed or wounded. Its courageous men failed to advance any further because the corpses were piled so heavily in the only break in the barbed wire that they had nowhere to go. In a matter of minutes, it was all over. The Newfoundland Regiment ceased to exist. Yet the order was given for the British offensive to continue, despite the loss of over 3,000 men in the first few minutes. And the attacks went on all day. When it was all over, the British had suffered 57,470 casualties in one day, the blackest day in the history of the British Army. Casualties is such a benign word, and statistics do not tell the story properly. When I talk to my classes about the Battle of the Somme, I ask them to imagine that they are looking out across Brentwood Bay on a clear day. Mount Baker is glorious and the sun sparkles on the ocean. Above, a 747 is making ready to land at Victoria Airport, but something goes drastically wrong and it crashes into the tarmac. A sickly smear of debris and a plume of black smoke is all that's left of the plane. The shock is palpable, and the tsunami effect of the tragedy emanates out from the crash site as stunned onlookers realize that 200 souls have perished. I asked the students to imagine further that all of the passengers on board were young male rugby players and their coaches headed to an international tournament in Victoria. Those young men who have died have families and friends who may never recover from the grief. Survivors, too, are victims, mourning the loss of the bravest and best of a generation. If you can somehow fathom the depth of that loss and imagine further that the same catastrophe repeats itself every 6 minutes from dawn to dusk that day, you will appreciate the horrific outcome of the first day of the Battle of the Somme. An offensive which was to go on for 4 months and cost over 1 million young men their lives, blunting forever the hopes of those dearest to them. Canada's young army was to earn at great cost a reputation as the shock troops of the British Army at the Somme, Vimy Ridge, and in Canada's 100 days at the end of the war. winning autonomy from Britain while laying the foundation for the Canadian identity. I asked my social studies class to read firsthand accounts of Canadian soldiers from the war and to show a sense of historical empathy by creating their own letters. Here are a couple of excerpts from the stories they penned, which will serve, I hope, as a tribute to those who suffered through the horrors of war, leaving an enduring legacy that we commemorate today. Hearing them, I trust that you will join us in vowing never again.
My dearest James, I cannot begin to express how much I miss you every day. The breaks between each letter you send feel like an eternity, as I have no way of knowing if you are alive and wonder if the next letter I'll receive will be a notice about your death. I feel so helpless from so far away, James, and would feel so alone in the world if I didn't have our children to comfort and keep me busy. George keeps asking me when you will come home. I never know how to respond. I cannot burden his young heart with the truth. I don't want to cause him any more sadness than he already feels with your prolonged absence. Elena is more observant. I think she sees the worry in my eyes, for lately she has been very helpful around the farm. She's become quite the cook. Her tomato soup is almost as good as mine. Since you've been gone, I have reconnected with my sister Jill. She moved into the area when she got word of her husband's death and came to live with his relatives along with our nephew Henry. She's great with George, who says he loves his new auntie. I cannot help thinking, though, how would I cope if I received the same news about you? I'm not sure if I could endure the pain it would cause. Jill seems to be doing well, though. She's gotten a job in one of the new munitions factories built in town. Apparently, it can be quite dangerous, but Jill says the risk keeps her focused on her work. I would also join the labor force for some extra money to spend if I didn't have the children to take care of. Many women have also volunteered with the Red Cross overseas, and I wish I too could help men like you through the horrible events of this war. Though the press tries to tell us otherwise, it is obvious that the war you're fighting is not a victorious one. I see the men that have returned home, too wounded to carry on, and pray that you stay safe wherever you are. There is so much pressure to enlist. I can't go 5 seconds walking through town without seeing some sort of recruitment poster or ridiculous white feather girl parading around. I know Jill is quite worried about Henry. He's almost 18, and all he can talk about is the war. The government is brainwashing us into thinking that leaving to fight is some sort of glamorous patriotic duty. I can tell from your past letters, though censored, that this is not the case. What we experience here at home must be heaven compared to the terrors you face, but we still have our own troubles. Food is scarce here, as you can probably imagine, but I remind myself daily we are better off than many families and are lucky to have each other through this terrible mess. With all my love, Mary.
To my dearest Mary, my final battle in this war was worse than any I had witnessed. The casualties, the weapons of havoc and destruction, the anarchy of it all. It's as if man had met his ruin on that day. Our commanders said we had won the battle, but it was clear to all of us there were no victors in war. Artillery cannons could be heard far off by the enemy line of trenches, followed by the wretched scream of mortars hurtling through the air. Machine gun fire tore through the fabrics of the cold wind, and the sounds of screams wrought from agony cloaked the battlefield. And the gas, you can't imagine what it did. I grabbed my rag drenched in urine and held it against my face, but the others, they suffered so terribly. Why? I saw it. I was there when the gas hit. I saw a man, slightly younger than I was, crawling through the mud on all fours like some wretched beast slowly dying from a hidden wound. His face was bare. No rag or mask shielded his lungs from death. The strength of his arms began to wane, and he fell slowly into the mud, a horrible pus-like fluid dripping from his trembling lips. He was drowning. There was nothing I could do. As his final moments came upon him, he looked at me. His eyes were fading to an opaque veil of mist. And he screamed, but it was muffled by the sound of war and the sickly fluid. But the atrocities didn't end there. The Germans, in a final and desperate attempt, ordered their men to charge. They were charging to their deaths, and they all knew it. As the wave of enemies grew on the horizon, our line opened fire, and bodies fell limply to the ground. Not many, but a few, made it to our trench alive and flung themselves in. I saw the German soldier on my left staring at me along the trench line. Neither of us moved. The battlefield became silent as we saw each other for who we truly were. His eyes were battle-worn, and yet they held a kind and caring look to them. His nimble fingers held a battered club with dexterity, but for a moment it seemed as though he had no intention of using it. He looked at once as a man of great integrity, dignified in his stance, humility glowing in his deep blue eyes. With tremendous roar, the sound of artillery shook the earth. We came back to reality. The friendly eyes I had been looking into suddenly rejected my gaze, becoming dangerous. The sounds of war blinded him, and he charged mercilessly towards me, club raised in the air. And yet, coming face to face, he hesitated. As the enormity of his planned course seeped into his mind, some power unknown by the battlefield held his arm back. But the moment passed as the sound of artillery cracked the air, and his eyes turned darker than before, and the club fell with great force. Just in time, I stepped quickly to the right, dodging the blow. Instinctively, but not truly willingly, I reached for the hilt of my knife, twisting it swiftly from my belt, and watching, almost detached from the horrific scene, as the glint of silver swam through the air and found its way to my enemy, striking terribly. His legs crippled under the force of death. It was tragic. He fell back towards the ground, hitting the drenched dirt floor. Blood ran from his chest and was lost in the dark mud. And then I saw it, the thing I feared the most. Upon his chest was a locket, smashed open by the force of the fall. In it were two pictures of beautiful children with innocent faces painted beneath an ashen, dreadful sky.
Thank you. My father hated balloons. Who hates balloons? In a memory of a memory, my mother is taking me aside around 4 or 5 to explain why no balloons at my birthday party. They remind him of explosions, she says. Cautions like these were part of the usual unusualness of life with my dad. He was a person of passionate likes and strange, almost whimsical fugues of anger. His mood could turn very quickly, and his whole manner of speaking, filled with references to books, movies, or the names of absent people, sometimes left me feeling confused, as if I was missing some important part of the story and had to assemble the rest myself from clues. Our house had more books than anywhere I had ever seen beside the library. He seemed to have read them all. He also knew classical music and sang a lot of snatches of opera, show tunes, but also army marching songs. Our basement was filled with model airplanes, theater props he had designed with my mother, carvings out of wood or soapstone, old hand tools, old papers. Included in the papers were notes he wrote about his time in the Korean War, when he served as a combat medic and a tank gunner, when he was only a little older than some of you. Here are a few of them, fragments of his notes and letters with pictures, his and others of the Korean War, that helped to tell his story. This is the tank. I was assigned to the tank the next morning, cold and still tired. I shouldered my bag and headed up the muddy road to climb what must have been a mile of hillside. I got there bushed. Sergeant Bragg, the tank commander, took my bag and helped me onto the apron behind the turret. I was still cold. Below me, I heard the twin diesels turn over, a deep growling sound that vibrated all through the tank. I held onto the spare 50 caliber machine gun barrel fastened to the back of the turret and let the heat and energy of the engines move through me. For the first time, I knew what it was to be part of the tank. I loved it immediately. I would always love it. The tank would be my mother and my home, my outer skin and all of my sense for months on end. Hard, rough, sloping, tender box of junk, all tread and hole and apron. Eyes, a sleeping monster, my tank, early monster, growing great in our darkness, not proud. You're the skin, rectum, anus, the cry and the hearing, the mouth, that I must be afraid. What can I say? You're frightened all the time. Some part of you is always frightened, always alert, always awake. Not to be frightened is mad, and even the mad are frightened. These are the statistics. Meet them. Patrols have to be run. The lines on the map have to be filled. They won't vanish. They are history and our authority. Patrol, heat-seeking in the darkness. Probe, without anger. Ears only, suddenly, all. I saw them coming down on their way back, snot and blood and vomit on themselves. Damn the hills and the valley below, damn the cold. Limping and leaning on each other, some of them cried. How many dead? I asked one man. Wounded? He shook his head. Men can survive on very little. A can of beans, a couple of onions, ants. Australian Aboriginals eat tree grubs, and some of them eat roots. Other men eat earth. Men sleep on stones. They circle themselves with bamboo to sheet the wind away. They burrow in caves, nest in trees, huddle under skins. We live in the ground and kill one another. I took to the uniform like I'd been born to wear it. I wasn't born wearing this uniform, strange as that seems now. I remember the ride back sometimes after we lost the tank, the heater in the Jeep and the talk up front between the driver and the shotgun, the open flaps behind me leaving the valley. I remember too, first of all, their hands, covered with dirt and streaked by engine grease and oil, gray in the cold, knotted and big-knuckled, long-nailed, the hands pulling me out of the tank. "Here, son," the colonel said to me, "you'll find that I am God." Then he ordered me to shave daily after my leg is seen to. You're dirty, cold, scared, sometimes lost, frequently tired, and you don't know when or how your life will end. Nobody talks about dying, that is accepted, but everybody talks about being mutilated by a shell, coming home in a basket, or coming home blind. We practice trying to do everything with one hand in case the other is blown away, either hand, daily. After you're wounded and sent out, somewhere in the process of this, in the recovery before you go back, the army kills pity, seeks it out and dismembers its integrity, destroys it utterly, as systematically as possible. The wound is no longer personal, it's objectified, smeared on a slide, taped to a table to talk about freely. You can go, cured. And the awful sense of personal vulnerability engendered by the bullet they described in training or the bayonet never goes away. Nonetheless, sleep remembers. The wound is slight, the flesh will heal, you'll never limp, no one will know, nothing will show, and the insult will pass, yet something limps inside him. The wound of being wounded. There is no naming it. We reached him together, the ROK medic and myself. Nowotny. Not Nowotny. Twisted gauze and splintered wood only, not organic, and indecent this way. I touched the sleeve and it collapsed. There was no arm. Only below, something flat and crimped against the hip, his hand, I think. He woke one morning telling us he smelled the sea. By noon, he heard it. And at dusk, he saw it. All night, he walked beside it, no longer with us. At dawn, a mortar killed him, swimming in sea. Anderson died last night. He said to me on the train from Fort Sam, Houston, that he and his father had never talked, as my father and I had, as men, to one another. He died not a boy, wherever you are, Mr. Anderson. I am issued a Colt 45 automatic and an M2 automatic carbine. We are also issued ammunition. It is a strange feeling to belt up with all that metal on you. You notice, first of all, how heavy it is. And you really know all at once that it is used to kill. Singled out today by a sniper somewhere on the ridge left of us. Followed. Odd. His first went into the snow, and the other dinged off the ice on the side of the tank as I moved away. Why should anyone, damn it, shoot at me? Are you kidding? Personally, initial response, and then anger. Last night's patrol came in with two prisoners. Jimmy B says they captured five. The other three, the infantryman told him, were marched into a bunker and followed in with hand grenades. One word. Nothing. Burned deep inside myself. Nothing. Nothing will survive. A fantasy. The war ended today. Don't laugh, it's true. The captain told us at noon. Probing patrols out from the main line of resistance found nothing. The enemy was gone, and the hills are empty. That side, they went, and everything went with them, not to return. They never were, Jimmy B says. There, where the guns were, high above us, eyes of the mountain, flesh of the mountain, ears and mouth, hunting us out daily, daily banging away at us. Something moves up there now. Something moves and does not. The war is over, yet something remains lion masked behind the guns up there. I watched the QMC and regimental rear torch our old clothes and sleeping bags with a flamethrower. Too many parasites to recover them. They carried them out on the end of a stick. I washed my face and shaved, and the gypsy gave me a haircut. Showered, counting the holes in lice and scabies, worked all over me in the dirt of the bunkers. I lost count. A new man. You got it made now, Dancy told me when I left company rear. Nothing but gravy right down the line. Maybe, just maybe. After a while, maybe. The veteran at home. All day alone, he sits in the room. Twice a day he eats, without interest and without appetite. I don't know if he sleeps. For a week, he stared into the wall in front of him, and at the end of the week, she brought the television set with a remote control. He might work from the chair. Months now, he plays with the set all day, watching it without sound or just looking at it, letting the changing pictures and lights reflect off his face in the darkened room. No visible wound. In the museum, remembering, I stand beside a child's suit of armor, measuring something. A child with no childhood wears a suit of armor. I wore it. How long? Can't even begin to remember that. What else? One question only. How do I get back into it? I saw the Roman Catholic chaplain today, standing over a couple of Chinese dead and praying from a book. Glover watched him, arms akimbo, standing behind. Damn him anyway, he says to me. Why doesn't he pray for us instead? He will, I promised him, when the time comes. I know this chaplain. After several months, I stopped carrying a weapon. Maybe I got religion. I'd come to feel that what I did, the care of the sick and the wounded, the solace of the dying, was good in the sight of God. If I went out for good, I had no complaints. I would have died doing what I loved most and what I knew to be right. It was a sense of faith I've never known at any other time. Out there with death always at your elbow, you live with God on top of you every moment of the time. It was impossible to be less alive. Every sound, smell, touch, word, thought mattered. Everyone and everything mattered. There were no inconsequentials, and one came to love in a very deep and strange way those who shared the moments with us. Any one of those moments could be the last. My dad was a challenging guy to live with, and I never knew if this was because of the war or because of him. We never talked about post-traumatic stress, but it may explain some of the things he did, like hating balloons, like not really sleeping at night when we were sleeping, like never speaking in great detail about the things I've just read to you. And some of the things he was, difficult, unpredictable, philosophical, political, angry, patriotic. The word patriotism can be roughly translated into devotion to the father. But we do not always know our parents that well, and war can alienate a person from himself fundamentally. Are these things passed on? Does my father's temper explain mine? Do we all carry with us hidden triggers? of unknown patrimonies. It has not been easy to stand up here and share this with all of you today, but I wanted to, because ultimately we make and remake these bonds deeper than blood, more powerful than decay, every day we spend with the people we love.
We will remember them. Today, on the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month, people gather at memorials to pay tribute to the millions who lost their lives to war this century. Perhaps veterans will remember comrades as they were a few seconds before death. Wives will think of the endless vigil waiting for their husbands who never returned. Parents will think of their children who left home for one last time. We at Brentwood might think about leaving the classroom, the playing field, or the studio to give the ultimate sacrifice in the battlefield. In the war cemeteries of Europe, a simple maple leaf inscribed in over 100,000 gravestones tell passersby that Canadians lie there buried because they lost their lives in battle. An awful price in human lives was paid by the youth of past generations. By the act of remembering today, we ensure that their sacrifices are not forgotten. Let us pay homage to the courage of those Brentonians who lost their lives and sacrificed. Please stand for the reading of the honor roll, the last post, the silence, and the reveille.
Old boys of Brentwood College, who lost their lives in the war of 1939 to 1945.
Alec Balecci, Dacher Barrett Leonard, Norman Beard.
John Bishop, John Bryden, John Campbell.
Arthur Coulter, Alan Dunlop, Alan Robert Field.
Ian Gillespie, John Gillespie, Bruce Hambury.
Barnett Harvey, Sholto Marlott, Alan Mayhew.
Ken Osler, Richard Proctor, Robert Proctor.
Lee Salter, Ralph Smith, John Stubbs.
Donald Stewart, Glenn Svensson, Michael Simmons.
Thornton White, Lawrence Wilkinson, Ted Williams.
Please be seated.
Remembrance Day is not a glorification of war. It is a call for peace. It asks each one of us, what have we done to make peace? Remembrance Day is a time for each one of us to think about what we are contributing to the future. Remembrance Day calls out that there should be no more names chiseled on gravestones of war anywhere in the world. The torch is being passed on, de manu in manum, from hand to hand, to you, the next generation. Let us all take a few minutes today to look into our hearts and to dream the dream of peace. In the lobby is the roll of honor of the Brentonian fallen. It was housed in the old chapel built by past Brentonians. When you leave in silence at the end of the service, please leave your poppy at the roll.